gonna build a mountain from a little hill.
Hey guys, and thank you so much for tuning into my channel. My name is The Lady Designer, and we are back with another speed build video of our city zoo. And in this episode, we're going back to Little Asia, and we're going to build a habitat for the Japanese macaque. This one is basically located pretty close to the orangutan habitat, which is the first habitat you would see if you go into Little Asia. Well, that's not actually correct, because there are two different entrances for Little Asia. But this is for one of the entrances, the first one we built, actually. So yeah, I wanted to stay in the same style, so I did use the same fence that I built for the orangutan habitat, and I also use it for this habitat. Because they're really close, I really want to try to stay in the same style of the habitats, and this building is definitely going to be in the same style as well. And I wanted to have this more round shape for this habitat, and that is different from the orangutan habitat, obviously, because that one is like straight in two corners, or actually three corners, and then there's this round shape. So it looks a little bit like each other, but it's still a very different building as well, because we're also going to have an indoor section in this habitat. So we're gonna have an outdoor and an indoor section. And this building definitely is a lot bigger than the other buildings that we have. I'm not even sure if, I think the Bengal Tiger one is around the same size, but it's a completely different style of building. But this one still might be a little bit bigger, actually. I did not really use anything as inspiration for this building. This was really just me playing around a little bit with the Asian pieces and stuff. So there is really nothing, no building at all that I use for inspiration for this particular building. So in case you're wondering, the path of this whole Little Asia area, or most of the places, is all a tiny little bit raised of the terrain. So if you're wondering how I am able to lower the terrain underneath the path, that's just because it's not exactly connected to the terrain. It's just floating a little bit above the terrain, actually, and that makes sure that I am able to lower the terrain whenever I want to. So I have a little bit more freedom in this area, and that makes it a lot easier to put down these fences and stuff right next to the path itself. So in the left and the right of the building, we have an exit and an entrance. So basically the guests can go from one side through the building to the other side of the building if they want to. There is nothing else, so I'm not expecting this building to be super busy on the inside as well. So I didn't want to go too wide or anything. I think on the inside it's only like 6 meters wide, and that's basically it. If there would be like a connection with other types of habitats and stuff, then you might want to go for a bigger width in path. But in this case, I was like, no, I don't think we need to. So I wanted to keep the style of the indoor section really more dense and more warm and more cozy and smaller. So I really paid attention to that. And in this case, you don't really have issues with that. What I did have, I had a lot of issues with these roof pieces. I don't know what it is with these Asian pieces, but they really, really frustrated me so much. There is really something off with playing around with the grid and these Asian roof pieces. I really don't know what it is, but it really, really is a pain in the butt. I really, really can't stand it. It really took me quite some time to get it right, because there are just pieces that are not really aligning, and it looks like they have their own grid in a way, and it just doesn't make any sense to me. But at least for me, fixing it a little bit was just going out of the building, then get back into the building and make sure that your grid height is at least on 1 meter. Because if I don't know, for some reason, I kept going back and it was on zero, and it just, I don't know, something is broken here. But that was for me just going out of the building, resetting basically the whole grid before you start using the pieces. That was for me a fix, but I'm really going to send this to Frontier, and hopefully they will be able to fix that in a patch soon. So the indoor section has three bigger window sections, but later when I added the fences, I noticed that I wasn't really able to use the glass fences, which I wanted to use in the first place. So then I decided to use the glass pieces that we have in the construction items. And later on, I had to reduce the three windows to two bigger windows, but it's totally fine. It's really not bugging me at all. There was this frustration with like the path in the beginning where putting them down on the inside, especially since everything is pretty close to each other and you have like this raised path going through a more lowered path, actually like more connected to the terrain, so we don't have any curbs. So yeah, you see a little bit of like wonky edges and stuff of the path itself, but it doesn't really matter because I'm covering it with some more flat tiles in the end anyways to make it really look like an indoor section in the end. So the middle section of the building on the outside, there will be like this circular entrance or gate for the Japanese macaque to walk in and out of their indoor to their outdoor habitat, etc. But I also obviously had to add a gate or like more of a door opening for the keeper itself to make sure that it would be able to go outside and to also be able to clean, but the Japanese macaque is also able to use those doorways. So yeah, actually that circular building is not really necessary, but for the idea, we just pretend that the Japanese macaque is not able to walk through the door. I'm actually not sure if there's like a trick to close the door in some way that the keeper will still use it, but the animals won't. I actually don't know if there's a trick for that. If you guys know, do let me know in the comment section down below, of course. So the building has like two more raised towers in the end, like just to give the building some more interesting vibe to it. And you will see me, I'm not really sure if that was already in the speed build or not, but you will see me at some points just raising the roofs again and again because it just wasn't high enough for my taste. But yeah, I'm really happy with how the building has turned out. It's decorated quite simple, like just as simple as the orangutan habitat, just with some wooden beams and some stone support pillars on the end, and that is basically it. Like, the focus really should be on the habitat itself, in my opinion. The downside, by the way, of that circular thing in the middle where the Japanese macaque can go from the inside to the outside is that I really don't understand. It's like a plaster piece, and the plaster pieces are like one of my favorite pieces because you have so many different variation of those pieces. You have so many different type of pieces that are non-grid pieces, like very small pieces and those kind of things. And also this circular wall is like the only piece that we have in the whole game, only in the plaster building set. And I just really don't understand why we don't have all these type of special things in the other building sets as well. Like, I can recreate it, it's not really an issue, but it takes pretty long to get it right. Like, I can recreate it with the limestone pieces, but that is just because I have these small little trims, which are also not in any other building style. So I really sometimes would love to see more similar pieces in every building style as well, because it's gonna make life so much easier, especially if they would use all the plaster pieces, all the small little items and all the flat items, and then just create those for other building sets as well. I mean, I can't imagine, like, a building set is just nothing more than like this wall texture, right? So they have the shape of all these plaster pieces, so why not just use those other textures and put them on those pieces? I really don't understand why that sometimes is. Like, it's the same with like the South America pack and the temple pieces. Like, you have a lot of temple pieces that you have in like non-colorable and recolorable, but you don't have all the non-colorable pieces in the recolorable items, if that makes sense. So it doesn't make any sense, actually, because I don't know, why would you not add all those pieces in? Is that like laziness? I don't want to call it that way, but it feels a little bit like that, because especially with the South America pack, it's like you're adding so many of the same pieces and you're making sure that we are able to recolor them and some are not able to recolor. But why don't you just add all of those items then so we can all recolor them? It just doesn't make any sense to me. So that is definitely also something that I'm just going to throw at Frontier and ask, like, hey, can we get those type of pieces in the same style but then recolorable, and the same with like the plaster pieces for all their building sets? I think that is like the least amount of effort if it's just a texture to put on them, right? But correct me if I'm wrong, like, I don't know too much about creating a game, but this sounds pretty simple and pretty easy to me. So yeah, I don't know. Anyways, back to the building. In the indoor section, we're going to have a lot of climbing frames and stuff. Nothing super spectacular. There's going to be a few beams going from one side to the other side of the habitat. It's going to be There are going to be some structures underneath it that will basically hold the beams, if that makes any sense. And there's going to be some vines to decorate it, and also for the monkeys, or the Japanese macaque, to be able to climb on. And I actually totally forgot about the fact that monkeys and primates are now also able to use ropes instead. I really used the vines with the idea like, oh yeah, because they can't use the ropes, but I totally forgot that they updated the ropes. So yeah, that is basically the only reason why I started using the vines, even though the vines do look really cool, but they might not really fit too much for a Japanese macaque habitat. So yeah, it's debatable, but still, I also use them for the orangutan habitat, so I don't think it matters too much. We're still trying to stay in the same style, I guess, so I think that's all good. But obviously, the outside of the habitat is, well, I started off way more tropical just because of the same thing that we had with the orangutan habitat. And you see me putting down, I think it's called the forage store box or something, forage box, something like that. And I tried to use that one because I really wanted to see if I could maybe be able to make some kind of hot spring. Because if you look for a Japanese macaque in real life, they can actually be found in natural hot springs. And it looks so funny. It's like seeing humans in a hot tub, but then it's like Japanese macaque in a hot spring. It's super funny to see. And I really wanted to do something like that and see if I could resemble that. So we started off with the forage box and making like this edge with rocks and stuff around it. And then, yeah, well, the only thing you really can do is like using those few of axes with water. But I don't know, it just didn't feel right to me and it felt very unrealistic, let's put it that way. And I just, I don't know, especially the view of axe, it just looked very weird. I think the idea would be fun, but I don't know, it just looked too weird to me, so I did remove the view of axe in a later stage and did keep like the surroundings and like the edges of the rocks and stuff. But I also felt like, yeah, well, for tropical habitat, it's not really going to fit. But yeah, realizing the Japanese macaque is really not a tropical animal. They're really like more snowy biome animal. So yeah, in the end of the day, I decided I was putting down like a lot of the mossy rocks and stuff to really decorate the habitat with, and the more I kept building and the more I had this idea in my head like, oh my god, the Japanese macaque are more colder climate animals, I should do something about that. This is not going to fit and people are going to complain most likely that the Japanese macaque should have a snowy biome in its habitat. Like, obviously in real life zoos you don't really see too many snowy biomes, but okay, for the idea. So yeah, in the end, I decided to go and take over the habitat and make it more snowy. Because actually, having mossy rocks in combination with snowy rocks actually look super cool. So I really thought like, you know what, I'm just gonna do it. The combination of the tropical rocks together with the snowy rocks, I think it's gonna look really cool. So yeah, okay, we don't have a hot spring, but we do get a very snowy biome in a later stage. So I'm actually really happy with how this habitat turned out in the end. So on the edge of the habitat itself, you may also notice that I use these temple pieces, like we just spoke about, the temple pieces that I also use for the orangutan habitat. I think that actually looks really nice for the habitat, even though I really would like to recolor those pieces. But yeah, we can't, unfortunately. But having them a little bit darker would look a little bit better, I think. But it's still, because if we also use it in the orangutan habitat, I think it really looks great still in the end to have that as an edge. And there's also some water around it, just like we did with the orangutan habitat. And also I used the mossy rocks underneath the water to create that more greenish texture underneath it. And I think that really looks nice, even though this is going to be more of a snowy biome, I think it still looks really cool. And the outdoor section of the habitat still has a few simple climbing frames, also decorated with some vines and some more small platforms that are sticking out on the edges of the climbing frames, just to make it all look a little bit more interesting and vibrant. And there also is going to be more of like this small little cabin, which is more raised up in the sky, well, up in the sky, just higher up with some poles. And I think that definitely for the sightline is looking way better, and also is a nice more shelter area on the outside still, if their monkeys are outside and they don't want to go inside, but they still want to cover for some rain, for example, that will be a perfect spot for them to chill and relax. And on the sides of the habitat, we will have two more lower platforms also using the food enrichment items. So hopefully the guests will be able to see the Japanese macaque more up close when they're looking on the outside of the habitat. So I think that definitely looks really nice, as well as with the mossy rocks and later on with the snowy rocks. Like, I did cut out a lot of the adding the snowy rocks because, well, I did. You can tell that I was really working towards a more tropical habitat with a lot of the mossy and tropical rocks itself. And then later on, when you decide to go for a snowy biome, then you really have to add a lot of the snowy rocks on top of all these tropical rocks. So it all took quite some time. So I did cut out a lot of that footage. And in general, I did cut out a few bits and pieces here and there of this footage because it was like a four and a half hour long build. So yeah, it took me quite some time comparing to other habitats. So that is why I really wanted to make sure that this video wasn't too long. So I did cut out a few bits and pieces here and there, which I think that are not really that interesting to see. And hopefully I am still able to continue talking throughout the whole video for you guys, because I really do enjoy lately to do these talks for you guys. So I really hope you guys enjoy this as well. Like, normally, if you're just new to the channel and you haven't seen many of my older videos, I was able to like talk for 10 minutes and then it's like, oh yeah, enjoy the rest of the speedboat video and enjoy the cinematic shots in the end, for example. But yeah, no, nowadays I am really in the mood to talk more often and longer in my videos. But yeah, these kind of long episodes definitely are challenging for me to really continue talking for the whole video instead. So the building itself is actually not really super detailed, and that is also because of the orangutan habitat. There is actually not that much. We use some of the stone support pillars, of course, to have like this edge on the path level. And then later on, we also have some more Asian pillars for some corner pieces. But I think like having the focus more on the habitat itself works just way better. And we also decorate a lot of the front of the building. I'm not really sure if that is what you call it. I think it's just the front, yeah. And we decorate it a lot with like bamboo and stuff. Like, bamboo can still be in this habitat. You could debate that a little bit, but like, if this will be real snow and it will be just fresh snow and there are also plants growing in the habitat, that is a little bit the idea you should have. Like, this is not a permanent snowy habitat, for example. So you still have like plants and stuff that would still grow. I'm not really sure if bamboo would grow in like permanently snowy habitats. If you guys do know that, do let me know in the comments down below. But they are also able to grow in temperate habitats and a little bit more colder climates, if I'm right. So yeah, using the bamboo is definitely something I wanted to do in this habitat as well, because it's also really fitting in this whole Asian, Little Asia area that we have going on right now. So yeah, I really wanted to use the bamboo pieces to create some variation into the habitat. So we have on the left and the right, we have some bamboo pieces. We also have some fountain bamboo pieces, if that is what they're called. And in the middle section, I also tried to use two or three bamboo pieces just to get like this nice skyline going on and to make it a little bit more interesting. Around the habitat itself, there are not that many plants. I did use a few of the, I'm not really sure how they're called, the ferns or brackens, I'm not really sure how they are called, to decorate a little bit. And the other more brighter, more wider colored bushes, I also forgot the name about those, but you will see those later on. But I didn't do too much with foliage around the habitat just because it is a snowy biome, so I didn't want to do too many crazy things. And I think it definitely looks well. Like, the Japanese macaque does not have any trees to climb on in this habitat. You could potentially decide to have like these broken Himalayan trees. I'm not really sure actually if they can also climb those dead ones. Like, I don't think they can with the laying logs, but there are also a few more dead trees that you could use, but I'm not really sure if they can climb on it actually. I didn't really think of that, but anyways, that could potentially be something that you could use for this type of habitat, but I did not use those pieces in this case. So obviously we also had to decorate the in the door section of the habitat itself and the viewing gallery. So the indoor section has these more wooden plates underneath it. That is also because I did do the same thing in the orangutan habitat. And I do remember that there were some issues with the orangutans climbing out of that indoor section to the outside because of the pillars and stuff. I don't know, there was some kind of issue with it and I did remember that, but I think it also looks just really nice to have these more climbing flat plates on the flooring of the indoor section. I do think that that wooden color just looks very well. We also have some feeders on the indoor section, and for the rest it's just mostly just covered with some hay and some toys on the inside as well. I don't think we have that many toys on the outside. We mostly have enrichment food enrichment items on the outside, to be honest, and that is basically it. And the indoor section where the guest can look into the habitat, that is mostly covered with the unpainted Asian pieces, and in combination with like red plaster pieces, just like we did with the Bengal tiger habitat. And that one is actually, again, inspired by the, what was it again? The giant panda habitat of Kuala Zoo. So yeah, there's a lot of inspiration from other projects as well in this one. But I do really love that red color with the plaster pieces. It really gives this more luxurious and a warm feeling to the inside of it. I also did cut out a lot of those footage as well, but I think it all makes sense to just cover walls and stuff with plaster pieces. And the rest, I also tried to decorate it with the Indian bins and the Indian benches because it just looks super cute, and especially for the inside, I think those are the best benches to use on an interior. I don't really like those for an exterior in the end. So yeah, that is Indian. I don't really mind, to be honest. And of course, we use some lights and also the Japanese macaque statues. They're actually so adorable. So I really should use those as well for the outside. Like, it didn't do too much on the outside, like around the habitat itself. I just put down some oak trees and that was basically it. But I actually should try and make some kind of garden when you walk towards the Japanese macaque with also these cute little Japanese macaque statues, because they look absolutely amazing. And I do remember that for Meilen Zoo, Mike Sheets also used them for the Japanese macaque habitat, like in an area in front of the habitat, and it just looks super amazing. So yeah, I think that is definitely something I should use more around this habitat, just to have some cute little statues, because I actually don't really play too often with statues and stuff. Like, filling in the gaps around habitats is definitely something I always leave towards the end of a series or something. So yeah, that's not something I have a lot of experience in. I do know that a lot of people are asking me, like, oh, I really would love some tips and tricks of how to fill in gaps in between habitats. But yeah, you probably don't notice it that much, but I don't really do that super often myself as well. Like, that is definitely something that I'll just keep open until I really, really have to fill something up for an end of a series, for example. So yeah, that is definitely, like, for example, these statues will look great on it, I think. So yeah, well, coming to the end of this video, I do really hope you guys enjoy this new Japanese macaque habitat. Do let me know in the comment section down below. Leave a like at the video if you guys enjoyed, and subscribe, of course, if you haven't already. And if you want to support the channel a little extra, you may want to consider to become a Fae Fam member with the join button of YouTube or via Patreon with the link down in the description. You can also find me on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitch. You can also find those links in the description down below. And yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. I really hope you all enjoyed, and I really hope to see you guys all in the next one. Thank you guys so much for watching. Bye, guys!